Somebody praise him. Somebody praise him. Somebody praise him. Blessing and honor and glory and power belongs to our God. Hallelujah. He is worthy of the praise and worthy of the glory. Come on, somebody. Anybody got a praise for him in here? Hallelujah. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Beautiful is the situation, the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion. Hallelujah. So it is the city of the great King. God is calling us living stones fitted together to house the habitation of the Lord in the earth. We are that house. We are that body that God has called for his glory. And we must meditate on that, think on that, and use that to impact change around us. Come on, somebody, and see the power of God manifest. See the power of God what? Manifest in our life. God is perfect. God is glorious. God is good. God is great. Come on, somebody. Magnify him in the house. I said, magnify him in the house. Glory to God. There is power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Those that know him know that there is power in him. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Paul says that the kingdom of God is not just word, it is power. Hallelujah. It is not just what? Word, it is power. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And he said that when he declares the word, he doesn't rely on enticing speech. Hallelujah. He doesn't let the people rest their feet upon clever speech, clever words, fancy speech and oration. He says, no, no, no. But on the demonstration and the manifestation of the power of the Holy Spirit. Come on the what? Demonstration and the manifestation of the power of the Holy Spirit. And that is real power. Come on, anybody can talk, and some can even do some things with the power that is entrusted to them by men. But there's a power from God, hallelujah, that is beyond the power of men, beyond the power of angels, beyond the power of any created being. And it's the power of God, hallelujah. And that power is available to us in Christ Jesus. That power is what? Available to us in Christ Jesus. And we wanted to know that power because the gospel is based on the power of God. It's based on the what? The power of God. Let's start with 1 Corinthians 2. Praise God. And read something about what Paul is talking about regarding the power of God. Regarding the what? The power of God. I want to talk somewhat about that today to inspire, to encourage your faith. Hallelujah. In believing in the power of God. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 2, reading from verse 1 says, and I, brethren, when I came to you, Paul says to the saints at Corinth, he says, when I came to you, I came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom. Declaring unto you what? The testimony of God. So he said, if I'm declaring to you the testimony of God, it must come with power. Hallelujah. It comes with what? He says, for I determined not to know anything among you, save who? Except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And that is clearly there that Paul wasn't coming with a religion. He's coming with a person of Jesus Christ and revealing him to those who will believe. And he said, and I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling, and my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom. Come on now. It comes with wisdom, but it's not of man's wisdom. Come on now. It comes with enticing words, but not enticing words according to the wisdom of men. But in the what? Demonstration of the Spirit and of the power. And now, demonstration of the Spirit and of the power. He said, my speech. And he said that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men. Your faith should what? Not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. In the what? The power of God. Hallelujah. Now that's some powerful word right there, telling us that that's where our faith must stand. What must our faith stand? In the power of God. Paul also said it in Acts 26, hallelujah, in regard to his testimony of what the Lord called him to do among the Gentiles. Hallelujah. And he spoke in verse 17 to 18. He says, the Lord sent him to, says, deliver thee from the people. The Lord said he will deliver Paul from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom he will send him. To what he's sending him to do. Verse 18 of Acts 26 says, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God. From the what? Oh, the Satan of power. Oh, yes. From the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Sanctified by faith that is in me. Come on. And so Paul was declaring, there's a faith in me I'm coming with that you need to know. Because look at the faith that you're sanctified by faith in. Faith in me. Look at the me. Hallelujah. Come on. That they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith in me. And Paul himself comes with a faith that reveals the power of God. Hallelujah. And those that believe in that faith, receive of that faith through the word of power. The word that is being declared is a word of power. Word of the gospel of the kingdom of God is the word of power. Come on. The power of God is being manifest to overthrow the power of Satan over man, to bring them into full relationship with God through his Son, Jesus Christ, and to let them have an inheritance in him, speaking about the kingdom of God, because they are heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ through Christ, the word that Christ declared, that Paul is also declaring to the people. And those who believe do receive of that power. Come on, somebody. Those who believe what? They receive of that power. Praise God. It is the power of God that saves. Hallelujah. It is the what? The power of God that saves, and the power is in the word that is being declared. The power is in what? The word that is being declared. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And that's why Paul said in Romans 1 verse 16 concerning the word he declared. He says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. That is the good news of Christ, the message that Jesus preached, which is the gospel of the kingdom. He preached, he says, for it is the power, what he says that word is. The word, the gospel of the Christ, is the power of God to salvation for everyone who what? Who believes. So it's for everyone who believes. For the Jews first, and also for the Greeks. For he said in verse 17, for in it, notice he used the word it, in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. Oh yes, there are different levels of faith. You can increase in faith. Release from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Hallelujah. The just shall live by faith. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And also in 1 Thessalonians 1 verse 5. 1 Thessalonians 1 verse 5. Paul says, for our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power. Come on. Our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and in much assurance, as you know what kind of men we were among you for your sake. Come on. In other words, it's not something we just talk about, Paul is saying, but this is something we live. Ah, Jesus. That's why he says the just shall live by faith. But he's talking about this faith that comes by the gospel. That's why he says from faith to faith. Glory to God. We are going from what? From faith to faith. Glory to God. And there's a faith in the Lord. Hallelujah. That is unlike any other. Glory to God. God is not sending us to you to bring you into religion. Once you say faith, everybody believe religion. And they ask you, what's your faith? They ask you, what's your religion? Come on. But here he's speaking of this faith as a life. He's speaking of this faith as a life. Come on. So it's not just merely a belief. Because James said even demons believe and tremble that there's a God. But there are still demons and there are still devils. But this is more than just having a belief. This, when he speaks of the faith, he's speaking of a life. The life of God in Christ. Come on. James 2 verse 19 says, thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. But that does not change them? No, it doesn't. So it's more than just having a belief when he says faith. But he's talking about having a life. Having a what? Come on now. Hallelujah. And the life is testified of in 1 John 5, verse 9 to 13. The life is testified of by God, and that is the word we bring about the kingdom. That kingdom life is called eternal life. What is it called? All right, watch it. 1 John 5, verse 9 to 13. It says, if we receive the witness of men, The weakness of God is greater. In other words, men have testimonies. Men bear witness by statement of what they have seen and heard. But he says, even God have a testimony. And he says, God has a witness. Oh, Shemasa. He says, if we can receive the witness of men, he says, the witness of God is greater. He says, for this is the witness of God, which he has what? Testified of his son. Oh yes, God has a testimony, and a testimony concerning his son. And he says, he that believeth on the Son of God has the witness in himself. Come on. There's an inner witness confirming in your spirit, huh? That the Son of God is of God. Hallelujah. And that the life is in him that you cannot have anywhere else. And he says that they have that witness in themselves. And he says, he that believe not God has made him a liar. Now, which spirit will let him think that what God is saying is a lie? Of course, it's the devil. And he says, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his son. So he doesn't just call it a testimony, a statement of what have been seen and heard, but he says it is recorded. In other words, it is written, hallelujah, that God gave a record concerning his son. And he says, what is that record? Come on. He that hath the son. This is the record, he says, that God has given to us eternal life. And this life is in who? This life is in his son. He that hath the son hath life. He that hath not the son of God hath not life. Now he's not talking about life as the mortal life, but he's speaking of life as the eternal life. So we see a difference between mortal life and eternal life. The life of man is mortal life. The life of God is eternal life. And he says, you can't earn this life. Oh, come on. He said it in Romans 6, verse 23, that it is a gift from God, and it comes in Jesus Christ. Because he says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. In whom? In Christ Jesus our Lord. And he says, now this is the record that God has given to us, eternal life, and this life is in his son. 1 John 5 verse 11 declares that, confirming what he says in Romans 6 verse 23. And he says, he that hath the son hath life, and he that hath not the son of God hath not life. And he said in verse 13, these things I have written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have what? You have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. Come on. Hallelujah. So we see then there is a life that Jesus came here to give us. Come on. He declared it, that who believe on him should not perish but have everlasting life in John 3 verse 16. But he also said in St. John 5, he declared about the eternal life, that anyone eat of his flesh and drink of his blood will never die. Still speaking about eternal life. Come on now. That's in St. John 6. St. John 6, reading from verse 49. He said to those Jews, your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. And he says, this is the bread which comes down from heaven, speaking of himself, that a man may eat thereof and not die. Come on now. And what? Not die, he says in verse 51, I am the living bread. Come on now. I am the living bread. And he says, which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. Glory to God. Huh? He shall live forever. That is eternal life. And he says, and the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world. Come on. And the Jews therefore strove amongst themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Come on. And what did Jesus say? Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink of his blood, you have no life in you. What life was he talking about? Eternal life, because they had life already in their flesh. But he's speaking about a different life here. The life that he says he has to give them. And he says, whoever eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood, come on, hath what? Eternal life. There it is. In verse 54. Hath eternal life, and I will raise him up. I will what? Raise him up at the last day. Come on. No, if it's speaking that once your body dies, there is no life, come on, then he would say to them, raise him up at the last day. Because that is speaking about resurrection. And resurrection can only manifest where there is death. Because he's speaking about being raised from the dead. Come on now. But he says that that person, though their body died, they still have eternal life. Glory to God. He says, whoever eats my flesh, drink my blood, have eternal life. He don't say they're going to have. He said they got it. And he says, and I will raise him up at the last day. So eternal life is the life of God in Christ. It's more than about the life of your human flesh. Because even those who have eternal life will receive the Son, their bodies still die. You got it? Their bodies still die. So how did Jesus say to them, those who eat of my flesh shall never die? Come on now. We take it in context for you to understand something here. Because we want to expose the armor in which the enemy is holding on to keep you in bondage to disbelieve the message. He wanted to understand what Jesus is saying here. When he says, anyone who eats of my flesh shall never die. He's telling them it is a spiritual life they received in him that is eternal. They are receiving the life of God that is in the Son. The life of God that is in the Son is called eternal life. The life of man is just mortal life. But the life of God is eternal life. And this life comes through the Holy Spirit. Come on now. This life comes through the Holy Spirit. And if anyone doesn't have this life, they can't be counted as being in Christ. Hello. Come on. Be going more. Come on, somebody. He says that he is the living bread that came down from heaven. Correct? And so the Jews were contemplating then, how does this man say that? This is verse 50. The Lord said, he's the living bread of man. And he says that any man eat of his flesh shall not die. That's in verse 50. And he said in verse 51, they will live forever. Anyone eat of this bread, he shall live forever. Come on. So he's not speaking about the body living forever. He's talking about the spirit and the quality, the kind of life that spirit will have with him, in him, and through him. Come on. With him, in him, and through him. And he's calling that life eternal life. It is the life of God in Christ Jesus. And he says, those without the Son cannot know that life. And anyone without the Spirit cannot experience it. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. That's what it says. Those who believe Christ have this witness within them. Come on. And who is that witness? The Holy Spirit. It says the Holy Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And he said if we are children of God, then we are heirs. Huh? That's Romans 8 verse 16 and 17. Right, the Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Hello? Glorified together with who? With him. Come on. And he said it in verse 9. That if the Spirit of Christ is not in you, then you are none of his. He's talking about the life of Christ. He says to the believers in Romans 8 verse 9, you are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. And here's the condition. If so be that the Spirit of God, that's the life of God in Christ. Come on. The Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man does not have the Spirit of Christ, so see there the Spirit of God is used synonymously with the Spirit of Christ. He says, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Come on, he's not his. Come on now. The Spirit of Christ is the Spirit of God. The Spirit of Christ is the life of God. And when that life comes into you, it must manifest through human flesh. You can't live just like a mere sinful, weak, flawed human being when the Spirit of God is living in you. Because he says, there's a greater one living in you that surpasses any weaknesses of the flesh. Come on. And Paul had some issues in the flesh that he prayed to God about and said, Lord, I've been beaten and battered, being buffeted by three angels sent by Satan to buffet me. Based on the burden of revelation you have revealed to me. Come on. He said he's suffering these afflictions and infirmities and attacks against him and his ministry because of this. And he besought the Lord 3 times that the Lord would take it from him. That's in 2 Corinthians 12, verse 7 to 9. It says, lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. And he states what it was. The messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord three times, that he might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in your weakness. And it's what is Paul's conclusion. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that what? There it is again, the power of Christ may rest upon me. Glory to God. Now, Paul wasn't talking about no sin. The thorn in his flesh was not sin. The power of God that rests on you for sin to remain. And when you ask the Lord to take away sin, he don't tell you to make it stay because grace is enough. No, he cleansed us from all sin. He said it in 1 John 1 verse 7. If we confess our sin, he's willing and just to what? Forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So don't let anybody fool you up in telling you about this is the weakness you have. You need sinning. That is your thorn in your flesh. That's the life on a pit of hell. Come on. 1 John 1 verse 9 says, if you confess your sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to what? Cleanse us. He don't just forgive us. He cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Sin is unrighteousness. And he cleanses us from all of it. Come on, somebody. Not for it to keep recurring, but for it to be no longer a part of our lives. And that's why Paul said it in Romans chapter 6, verse 1. He was speaking to some people that believe, said grace is an excuse for sin. And he wanted them to understand, not so. Grace is not an excuse for sin. Grace is the end of sin. You should not continue in sin and say, well, grace abound towards me. Grace is plenty towards me. He says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? What did he say in verse 2? God forbid. In other words, God will not allow that to happen. He says, how shall we that are dead to sin? What did he say about opposition to sin? Dead to sin, live any longer therein. He says, how can we continue to sin if we're dead to it? That's the point. He says, how can we who are dead to sin live any longer therein? Can't live any longer in that sinful life. No way. Because what he says to them, it reminded them in verse 3. He says, know ye not that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ and were baptized into his death? Come on. Sins were nailed to the cross. There was no resurrection day for it. Hallelujah. So he says, that was nailed to the cross. He says, we were baptized in his death. Huh? Come on. And buried with him by baptism into death. That like as Christ was what? Our sins was not raised when they were put to death. What Christ that bore our sins took it to that cross, and suffered the affliction and infirmity, suffered the wounds, and suffered death to put that sin to death in our life. But he rose up on the third day. Come on. He says that as Christ was raised up from the dead by the what? Glory of the Father, even so also we should walk in newness of life. He don't say we continue to sin and say, well, the Lord, no, we are just human beings and we're sinful and we live in a sinful world. No, he says, now we who have been baptized into Christ, we understand that that old life is dead and buried. We were baptized in his death and we were buried with him, that as he raised, we should also raise and walk in newness of life. He says, for if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. And note, Jesus did die committing no sin. Jesus was tempted in all ways, yet without sin. He died in obedience, not in disobedience. So he says, if we share in the likeness of his death, we will share in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is what? Crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should what? We should not serve sin any longer. Hallelujah. That's a good word right there. That doesn't sound good for sinners. Because sinners love sin. But the Lord wants to change you from a sinner to a saint. Those who are in Christ are not called sinners. They are called saints. In case you have forgotten that word, check every part in the New Testament who Paul is writing to. He's not writing to sinners. He said he's writing to the saints. The saints in Rome, Romans, the saints in Corinth, Corinthians, the saints in Thessalonica, Thessalonians, the saints in Ephesus, Ephesians, the saints in Philippi, Philippians. You check everyone is writing to the saints. But now they call themselves sinners, saved by grace. Because they're still sinning. I believe grace alone will save them. But you are saved by grace through faith. You are saved by grace through what? Faith. And faith without works is dead. It requires corresponding actions. Come on. So faith is not just belief. It's a life. Faith is not just belief, it's a life. Come on. This is the faith we have come into through Jesus Christ. The word of God says the law came by Moses. But Jesus brought faith. Faith came by Jesus Christ. Come on, somebody. Hello. Glory to God. As St. John 1 verse 17 and 18 says, for the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man had seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. In other words, it's the Son that revealed the Father. Woo! Glory to God. And it says Moses was a faithful servant. But the Son speaks of greater things. Yeah. And the Hebrew writer was letting us know that the Son is greater than the servant. Come on. And you got to hear what the Son has to say, because as Hebrews said in Hebrews 1, verse 1, it says, in sundry times, different times and places, God spoke in time past. Huh? In times what? Past unto our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, how is he speaking to us? He's speaking unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, and by whom also he made the worlds. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. So he declared Jesus as the greater one to Moses. Hallelujah. And he says, the word that is brought, it comes with power. Come on now. He said in verse 3, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, being made so much better than the angels, as he had by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than angels. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Give me some more. Hallelujah. For unto which of the angels he said, did he say at any time, thou art my son, this day I begot thee? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. No angels ever said that to him. Come on. And again, when he bring in the first begotten into the world, he said, and let all the angels of God worship him. And of the angels, he said, who maketh his angel spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. But unto the Son, he said, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Come on. Some believe it look like his love changed over the years. Because the more they sin, the more they say the Lord loved them. But he says, he loved righteousness and hated iniquity. And he says, therefore God, as all God addressed his Son as God. But he says to the Son, your God. Does God have a God? Yes, man, there it is. Therefore God, even your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness above your fellows or your companions. Huh? Come on, somebody. So it's not just his sons. He's not just Jesus, his father. But he's Jesus, his God. And he says, thou Lord, in the beginning. He also called Jesus Lord. Not just God, but now Lord. And he says, thou Lord, in the beginning, has laid the foundation of the world. And the heavens are the works of thine hands. They shall perish, but thou remainest. And they all shall wax old as not a garment. In other words, they will wear away. As a vesture, thou shalt fold them up. And they shall be what? And they shall be what? Oh Lord, that change is coming. That's what Paul was talking about in Romans 8, where it says, all creation is waiting for them to step into the liberty of the sons of God. When that glorious change manifests, we shall be changed, and all creation will be changed also. A new heaven and a new earth. He says, but thou art the same, and thy years shall not fail. But to which of the angels said he at any time, sit at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool? None of them. Come on. Hello. But who did he say that to? He said that to the Son, Jesus Christ. But he also said it to us, because he says we are seated in him, in Christ Jesus, in heavenly places. Hallelujah. And our life is in him. Come on, that's why the writer John says, when he appear, when he, our life appear, we shall appear with him. Come on. Are they not our ministering spirits, he says, sent forth to minister to them who shall be heirs of salvation? Come on. Angels are sent to minister to those who are heirs of salvation. But he says, hey, but the Son, he says, you sit at my right hand. And he command angels, worship him. Come on, somebody. Something supernatural takes place when you embrace the word of God, because the power of God is in the word of God. And those who believe in the word of God believe in the power of God. Come on. And if you believe in the power of God, it must carry corresponding actions. Hallelujah. Right, so if you understand the principle of what you're doing, that God is calling you into a true fellowship and connection with him through his Son, Jesus Christ. And that's why Jesus says, none can come unto the Father but by me. They must be empowered to do so. Did you get that? God is the word that become flesh and dwell among us. As he stated in St. John 1 verse 40, the word become flesh and dwell among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So he says, how does one become a child of God? They must receive power to do so. And that power comes through the word. Comes through the word of God. And it says, the word, that same word that become flesh. In St. John 1, it also said it from verse 11 to 14. He said, he came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, him who? The word that became flesh, that's Jesus. To them he gave what? The power, the right to become. The right is given to you to become through the word of God. Come on. To become sons of God. Even to them that believe on his name. Which were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but born of God. That's why they're called children. So they're called children of God through the word of God. So they reject the word of God, they cannot become children of God. Hallelujah. Because we are children of God through the word of God. And isn't that good news? That we can believe on the word and embrace the word, and the creative nature and power of the word transform us into children of God. Not merely part of his creation, but part of his family. Come on. Because angels are part of his creation, but they're not part of his family. He never called the angels his son. I never call an angel his child and say, I'm your father. No point does an angel call God father. Not one point in scripture. Because the right has to be given by the word of God for them to do so. And God never called an angel his son. Hello. Praise God. And that's awesome to know that God give you right through word to become children of God. To become what? children of God through the word of God and say, by doing so, he's making you an ear. He's making you an ear, one who has an inheritance in his kingdom. He says he did not make any angels ear to the kingdom, but he makes you an ear. Come on now. Ear means that it belongs to you. It is your inheritance. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Ears of God and joint ears with Christ. Glory to God. That's what it says in Romans 8, verse 17. That's who you are as children of God. 16 and 17 tell, because you are children of God, then your ears, the angels are not children of God. They are not ears, but he made us ears. Come on now. He made us what? Ears. And that's the same thing in Hebrews 1. Hallelujah. It's in Hebrews 1. Hebrews 1 verse 1. Hebrews 1 verse probably was 6 to 7. It's the five talks that he has never said to you, to any angel. There is, he's his son. That's five, right? But I'm talking about the one with regards to ears, right? Okay, and he says, right, yeah, verse 5 says it too. For unto the angels, he says, hath he not put in subjection the world to come, wherever we speak. In other words, it says, he has not put the world to come in subjection to angels. Watch that in verse 5. That's Hebrews 2, verse 5. Okay, I was looking at the chapter 1. All right. Hebrews 2, verse 5 says, he has not put in subjection the world to come and the angels wherever we speak. But who did he put in subjection to? The ears. So Jesus is the ear, because he speak about him being the ear of all things, because he made all things. He's the ear of all things. And we are joint ears with him. Come on. So that's why it talks about us being not just having our sins being pardoned, but gaining our inheritance in him. Our inheritance. It's more than about you being saved from sin. You have an inheritance. It's talking about the kingdom of God. Talking about the what? Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. So he said that we know for sure that he did give it unto us as he did it, give it unto Christ. Because he says, fear not, little flock, it is your Father's good pleasure to give to you the kingdom. Come on, somebody. Is that Luke chapter 12? Hallelujah. Praise God. Luke chapter 12, verse 32. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to what? To give you the kingdom. Come on. But he did not give the kingdom to angels. Come on. You are children of God. And that's more than just saying, I'm created by God. You have to be given rights to be a child of God through the word of God. Not everything that is created by God is God's children. You need to understand that. So this is a right being given to us, so much so that John said it in 1 John 3, verse 1 to 3. He says, beloved, what manner of love? Huh? What manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called sons of God. He says that we get up and just call ourselves son of God. He said, it is God that gave us that word to become sons of God. Come on now. that we should be called sons of God. He says, therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. He said, the world doesn't know us, because the world doesn't know him. And why does the world know him? Because they rejected the word. And it's through the word they know him. And it's through the word you become a son. Watch the thing. He says, beloved, now, when are we? He said in verse 2 of 1 John 3, beloved, now are we sons of God. And it does not yet appear what we shall be. In other words, we still have the appearance of human being with this human being body. But God is making your children of God more than just body being. With this human needs taken from the dust. The body God offered you didn't come from the dust. Come on now. And that is spoken of in 2 Corinthians 5. Huh? But here he's saying, it does not appear to us what we shall be. In other words, it's not going to look like what we have on now. Because if what we have on now, he wouldn't say it does not appear, does not yet appear what we shall be. He says, but we know that when he shall appear, who shall appear? We shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. He's talking about in his true form. Not in the appearance of men that he came in here. But in his true form as God. And as son of God. And he says, every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. Come on now, somebody. Are you like that one? Glory to God. He told us then that those who, when he appear, we shall be like him. And he says it also, Paul speaks about it also in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 1 to 5. He tells us it's a different body being given. A different what? Body than the body we have now. A tent is not a building. A tent is not a building. And Paul compares the two body in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 1 to 5 there. He says there, for we know that if our earthly house, speaking about this body, if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building. We have a what? A building of God. And house not made with hands. Means that human being didn't have nothing to do with that body. We got this body from human beings. But he says that body we get it from the Lord is eternal in heavens. And it's not one that man had nothing doing to create. Come on. He says, for in this we groan. In this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house, which is from heaven. Come on. Our house, which is, this is not no mansion on a hilltop. He's talking about a different body. You don't clothe yourself with your house. But he's talking about this body because he says the earthly house and he talk about heavenly one. But look at this one because he says, he don't say it is heaven. He says it's our house which is from heaven. That verse 2 tells you clear. Desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. It is not heaven, it is from heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. In other words, if we get disqualified, we will not get that body. Come on, because if you're not faithful in the one that is temporary, how will you be faithful in one that is permanent? He says, for we that are in this tabernacle do groan, be burdened, not that we should be unclothed. In other words, not because we aching to die. But he says, but clothed upon, in other words, to be further clothed. That mortality, that's human life right there. Mortality might be swallowed up of life. What life is it swallowed up of? Eternal life. Come on now. Now he that hath wrought us for this selfsame thing is God. In other words, the one who is preparing us for this is God, who also hath given us the earnest of the Spirit. That Spirit that bear witness with our spirit. Don't consider yourself just being your flesh and blood. He said, no, yes, the Spirit is bearing witness with your spirit. It's not bearing witness with your flesh. It's bearing witness with your spirit that you're a son of God. And he says, there's coming a time when that mortal will put on immortality. And God is immortal. He calls the all-wise immortal God. And he says, you're putting on immortality. So he says, you're putting on a new body. And Paul speaks about that new body being raised in 1 Corinthians 15. Ah, glory to God. And he tells us that, hey, the new body you're getting is not like the one that you're sowing here. Because he says, this is but grain. But the one that is coming up is God determines a body for it. Huh? 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 36 to 38. Some was asking them, oh, is the dead raised? What kind of body will they have? Paul said in verse 36, thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened or made alive except it die. In other words, it have to die to see resurrection. But then it goes further and says, that which thou sowest not that body that shall be. So what he called that body your soul? He said, that's just being rain. It may have a chance of wheat of some other grain. But he said, but God give it a body that he please. Come on. That please him. To every seed his own body. Come on now. Hello. God determined a body to give it. So we said, when we sow a seed, what springs up out of the ground don't look like the seed. And that's what he's saying. After resurrection is not letting you come back with that same body. Come on now. He says, no. For those that are in Christ, they are going to be clothed with a new body. But those that are not in Christ, they'll be clothed with the same, only to face destruction. Come on. That's the key note right there. So in him we have life, and life more abundantly. Praise God. And that life is the God kind of life. That life is what? So he called us to live in newness of life. And we don't have to wait till we die to live it. He says, anyone that had the Son had that life. When? Now, because he says, beloved, now are we sons of God. Now, come on. So you say, you don't have to wait to say, when I get to heaven, you might not get there. But you need to line up your steps with the Lord, embrace his word, and the power of his word will manifest in you. And reveal the life of God in Christ, which is holy, which is righteous, which is perfect, which is well-pleasing to God, which is obedient, which is humble, which is faithful. Come on, somebody. All the qualities of Christ must bear evidence in you. Come on. And those who know and believe the word, I've seen that already in their life. So why not you too? Come on now. Come on, stand here. We're going to pray. Our time is up. Praise God. Hallelujah. The word has gone forth. And you need to ask yourself, am I really embracing that power? Do I believe in the power of God? Or am I making excuses why I can't do it because of my flesh? Because if you really accept him, then you can say, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Whatever is working in your flesh, if the Spirit of God comes and dwells in you, he says you are dead to sin, but alive to God through Jesus Christ. He wants you to know that life. It is eternal life. And you can have it in Christ Jesus. For he came that you might have it. He's not waiting for you to die and give it to you on the other side. He says he came here that you might have it. We're here. Here and now. And he says those who believe shall never die. They will pass from life to life. Come on. But those who don't believe will pass from death to death. Come on. Father, we thank you for your word. We know you're speaking to our hearts today. To think, to consider deeply about this great salvation. This great offer that you're giving to mankind to become part of your family. They are already part of your creation, but not all that is of your creation will be saved. And not all that is of your creation have an inheritance in you. But you're calling us to become part of your family and to have an inheritance in you. And I pray even now, everyone who has heard will look into themselves and consider what will they give to really gain such an offer. And the Lord says, they must believe with all their heart. Confess with their mouth and believe in their heart that it is true and embrace it in their lives. And you said the word will do the work, because it's not of ourselves, but it's of your power that worketh in us. And so I pray right now, that same power, hallelujah, that you release to raise up Jesus from the dead, above all principalities and powers, rulers and darkness, and seat him at your right hand. You said that same power is working towards those who believe. And so, Lord, let them, through faith now, connect with that power and see the power of God manifest in every area of their lives. Whatever the devil has encroached upon, weighed down and hindered, corrupted, perverted, deformed, derailed, this place, your anointing is able to pull it back and to put it in its proper place, to reveal your kingdom operating in their lives. And so I pray right now, grace will be greatly multiplied to them to rise up and to possess their inheritance in Christ Jesus. For you love them, and it's your great pleasure to give it to them. But they must give it up all, deny themselves, take up the cross, and follow you. Let self be slain. Let you be seen, O God, and manifest in their hearts that they will rise up as true children of God, and not as mere men, as a prey and weak to the elements around them and subject to things that cannot see. But I pray that you will manifest your power in their lives now to transform, to heal, and to save that which was lost. As we entrust them in your hands, in Jesus' name. Come on, give God the praise right now. 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 Glory to God. Father, we thank you. Thank you for hearing us and for stirring up faith in our hearts. Now we know you have already begun the work. And you who have begun the work, you're faithful to do what you said you would do. For you watch over your word to bring it to pass. So right now, let the words of our mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Lord, you are strength and our redeemer. Come on, give him the praise one more time. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. He be blessed by the word. Praise God. We're going to sign up now. We got to go and release you. Praise God. The rain came down. The rain has stopped now. And praise God. Time for me to run out too. Hallelujah. Just in time. Bless the Lord. Give you a chance to sow as the Lord has laid upon your heart. Hallelujah. And also allow the Lord to bring us into the fullness what he has in store for us. If you want to know more about this ministry, it's Increasing Faith Deliverance Ministries International. We are at 3 East Street, Montego Bay, Jamaica. I'm Apostle Richard Fagan, declaring the gospel of Christ and his kingdom. I encourage you to really dig deep into the word. Don't just be passive and surface relationship with the word. Get deep in the word. There's so much that God wants to reveal to you. And there's so much God wants to do in you and through you and around you. All it requires is your willingness and your obedience. Come on. And if you're willing and obedient, surely the power of God will match every step you make to make you make too. And will give you, reveal his strength even in your weakness. So I encourage you to pursue diligently the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Pray and ask the Lord to forgive you of your sins, and ask him to send his Holy Spirit to make dwelling in you, to fill you with his Holy Spirit, and allow the Holy Spirit to lead it to a place where you can receive spiritual support and leadership, being properly discipled in the ways of God through the servants of God that Jesus has provided. In Ephesians 4 verse 11, he gave some to be prophets and apostles and evangelists, pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints and equipping of the ministry. So he wants you to come into that fullness. So we encourage you not to take it for granted, but to extend yourself and move out and connect with those who the Lord wants to connect with. Ask the Holy Spirit to lead you to connect with the right person that he has appointed for you, for his God. And he knows his servants. So you don't have to judge by appearance, but trust the voice of the Lord and listen to him intently, and he will reveal to you who you must connect with and how to move forward in building your faith, your relationship and life in the presence and power and spirit of God. Hallelujah. So I continue to pray for you, and I hope that you can connect with us more to keep building your faith. Hallelujah. If you want to see us every time we go live, just send a friend request to be Richard Fagan on Facebook, and you'll be plugged into the live stream every time we go live. Or you can see the recording at your own convenience on our YouTube channel. Just subscribe to Richard Fagan and you'll be hooked up to all the recordings there. You can also check out our website. It's Increasing Faith intl.org. That's Increase in Faith, intl.org. Praise God. You can go anytime. You can sow to the ministry through that means. And also, you can write your prayer requests in the comment box. And also, your praise report to all this ministry blessing you in the comment box. We rejoice to hear from you and to hear what God is doing. We really are blessed and encouraged to hear what God is doing in the lives of others as we give ourselves completely to His work. We expect greater changes and manifestations to manifest that we bring glory to God. And we continue to pray your strength as you will continue to pursue Him even more to see greater works being done in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you want to know anything more about the ministry, you can call me, Richard Fagan, at 876-839-9390 or 876-557-2427. Our book is also out there that we've already published on Amazon. It's also on Kindle. You can look for the book. It's called The Gospel of the Kingdom, The Gospel that Jesus Preached. It's in Matthew 4, verse 23, and Matthew 9, verse 35, and Matthew 24, verse 14. It says, that's the gospel. Everywhere he went, he was preaching that gospel. The gospel of the kingdom of God. And so we wanted to know what he was preaching. And it is summed up in the bottom of the gospel of the kingdom. We put a little foundational nuggets together that will help you to have a good solid foundation in understanding, beginning to understand. Because we couldn't put everything in there. We could not be held in that book, but just to lay the foundation for you to have a greater clarity of understanding in about the gospel that Jesus preached. Amen. So we continue to pray for you. And on next time, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. Praise God. Hallelujah. You're blessed today. Praise God. I'm blessed to serve you. I'm blessed to have you here. And blessed to those who took special time to watch us. We release special blessing over you too and over your household and over your business and your ministry. We pray that you will increase more and more as you continue to connect with us in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, we thank you and praise you. Great is your faithfulness. Continue to lead and direct us and manifest your power greater and greater in our lives as we yield to your leadership in our lives in Jesus' name. Amen. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord open His countenance upon you and give you His peace. God bless you. Have a great day in Jesus' name. Bless you all.